following the media last week, the CCSSO held their Washington week, and I was in attendance. So I got a lot to say. But I was heading this week, this exact, just about this time last week, I was heading into the Department of Education to meet with Secretary DeVos. I sat in a circle with other state educators of the year around the nation, and I listened to people who are now my friends, my fellow teacher peers, advocate for increased student resources, higher teacher salary, educator autonomy, and decreased standardized testing. While the secretary patiently and graciously listened, there were many questions that were left unanswered, or that received disheartening and worrisome responses, or suggested that public education is failing. I am here to tell you with great emphasis, we are not failing. In fact, would any teachers, both past and present, in addition to our already standing educators, anyone else in the room, teachers, past and present, would you please stand? Thank you. Thank you for your empathy, for your hard work, for your creativity, and for your joy. I am certain that students around the state, students like my two sons and the kiddos with me here today, are better because of the relationships that you foster with kids, that we foster with kids every day. And while there are struggles in public education that require immediate and intensive attention, I assure you that we are staunchly committed to prompting student growth, elevating their informed and compassionate voices, and building authentic connections. Alas, there's work to be done, and we can do better. But I have to tell you before I go any further that one of the things that I realized last week is that I am unbelievably fortunate to teach in the state. And I kind of didn't know that before I went. I kind of went into the Sussex Tech classroom, and I shut the door, and I really crushed it in there. I'm ready to crush it statewide, in case you're wondering, you can chat afterwards, we'll crush it together. But I just heard so many voices from around the nation, and mine was mostly positive. So thank you for affording me the opportunities that you have. So when I think about doing better, I've been spending a great deal of time considering and working toward racial equity in our schools. Creating a curriculum that promotes diversity and courageous conversation has been at the heart of my classroom since I first entered Sussex Tech. Teaching composition, literature, and creative writing to motivated and empathetic high schoolers has afforded me an incredible opportunity to listen to the stories. It's important, right, that we allow our children to tell their stories. We listen to the stories of students who have struggled to find equality, who demand equity, who search for educators who will elevate and challenge rather than limit and stereotype. And even though my intentions have always been sincere, not all students have equally benefited. What I realized many years ago that I was, and I continue, to limit students simply because of my physical appearance. As a white 46-year-old educator, I have learned that student comfort is sometimes dictated, often related to my race, to the implicit biases that exist in classrooms around our nation. This uncomfortable realization was sparked by one of my African American seniors in a creative writing class I teach. I'm going to step away from my speech for a second. I wrote this a couple of days ago, but I got a phone call yesterday morning from this very student. Ashley is someone who I've been talking about a little bit because she's been profoundly developmental in her role as a teacher. And she called, and she was like, "What are you talking about?" So it was about 15 years ago. And we have decided to sit down together to talk about the moment I'm about to explain to you. We're going to revisit that moment. And how that moment felt when she articulated what I'm going to share with you, which is 16 or 17, and how it feels now that she is a 30-year-old woman. How it felt for me as an educator, I'm about to explain, but I need her to hear how it felt then and how I've grown as a result of it. So that conversation is yet to come. So Ashley, back to my creative writing classroom. We were navigating through a difficult conversation regarding racial profiling. And my creative writers and I were listening to one of my students. He was sharing a negative experience he had in his first-person narrative. My students were weighing in, and that's what we look for, right? They're sharing perspectives, they're engaging in ways that make me so proud, and then actually raised her hand. She noted that she appreciated what I was trying to do, that she knew it was important to have discussions, that that unveil the hidden and sometimes not so hidden racism in our communities and in our schools. She also said something else to me. She said, "You know, Mrs. Forcucci, I love you, but I will never trust you the way I trust a brown person." And at first I was hurt, then I was offended, next I was embarrassed. Finally, I considered that statement from Ashley's perspective instead of my own. What must this 17-year-old have experienced to distrust someone who looked like me? How must it feel to sit in classrooms for all those years, wondering if the person leading her had her best interests at heart? So here's the questions I had to ask. The single question I had to ask. How do teachers who look like me motivate students who do not? I needed to understand, I needed to learn how my whiteness impacted the learning of my students of color. But I need to pause for a moment, I need to pause to emphasize the complexity of race in our schools, in our communities, and in our nation. It would be irresponsible and totally arrogant to suggest that I have absolute solutions. What I have are experiences that have helped me recognize my growth and my need for more. While my search for understanding began almost 2 decades ago, I know I'm still looking. I'm still looking for clarity. I'm still growing. I'm still hoping to better serve all of my students. So ladies and gentlemen, policymakers, child advocates, please hear my first call to action. We need all teachers, both current and pre-service, to engage in equity training, to be culturally competent, so that they are better prepared to serve and embrace the diverse voices and experiences that await them each day in our classrooms. Educators must constantly reevaluate, introspect, and most importantly, listen. I mentioned it earlier, we must listen to the students who deserve empathetic and rigorous instruction in our classrooms all the time. But beyond the understanding and awareness, there also needs to be representation. Students must see teachers and administrators who don't look like me. So, request number two, we need mentoring programs that start at the post-secondary level and reach into our high schools as well as our middle schools to recruit the best and the brightest, to encourage children of color to pursue our noble profession. What we know, you all know, is there is an unbelievable teacher shortage around our nation and in our state, and teacher turnover is highest for teachers of color. Consider the power of long-lasting educational partnerships between pre-service teachers and our motivated youth, our youth who thrive when the racial and ethnic composition of the professional staff is equal to the student body. If connection prompts comfort, and comfort prompts progress, a mentoring program would benefit everyone, new teachers, veteran teachers, and especially our deserving students. Now, there's one more. Let's take advantage of the organic mentoring that occurs between teachers who are parents and their children who grow up in educators' homes. How many of you, so please raise your hands if you'd like to contribute, How many of you know of families who boast of generations of effective teachers? Parents, grandparents, children who are educators. Okay, yeah. I have kids. Growing up in a home where a child sees the love of all kids is indeed the best training to be effective in the classroom. However, I must admit that my husband, also an English teacher in the same school as where we met, and I have had our teacher talk turned it end up against us at our own dinner table. A couple of years ago, when our oldest son was about 11, his name's Finn, we were discussing his less than stellar performance in one of his classes. That child looked me right in the eyes, furrowed his beautiful middle school brows, and he said, "Mom, come on, how am I supposed to thrive without appropriate classroom rigor?" I assure you, my kid's going to be one heck of a teacher one day. His wit assures me of that. Offering incentives to out-of-state teachers, to pre-service educators in our post-secondary institutions should be considered. As modeled by McDaniel College in Maryland, children of educators are eligible for scholarship money, $100,000 to be exact. It just makes sense that more professionals would choose to teach in our state knowing their children will receive a tuition reduction. My husband and I have devoted a combined 48 years to teaching in public schools. and we will not be able to afford tuition for our two sons without loans. I found this problematic, and I found it defeating. How is it that two people who dedicated their lives to preparing kids for college readiness cannot financially ready our own sons for a four-year degree? So there you have it. Equity training, mentoring programs, teacher incentives. We can do this. Together we can do this. I told anyone who will listen, and I said this a second ago, but it's worthy of repeating, that I feel incredibly fortunate to teach in Delaware, to be supported by legislators who value education, our children, and our continued progress. I sincerely thank you for your years of service, your leadership, your continued commitment to what's best for our state's youth. I thank you for your advocacy.